Hello, church. Let me be the first to welcome you here today. We're so glad you decided to join us. Make sure you share this service with all of your friends by clicking the share arrow at the bottom right-hand side of your screen on Facebook so that all your friends know the amazing stuff we're doing here at Crest Hill. If this is your first time joining us, make sure you say hi in the chat so that we can welcome you and so that we know you're here. We know you're not here by mistake and that you clicked on this worship service today for a reason. So wherever you are, in the kitchen, in the living room, even in your PJs in the bedroom, or at Crest Hill, let's worship together.
Let's worship together.
Let's worship.
Let's worship together.
Let's worship.
Let's worship together.
Let's worship together.
Let's worship together.
Let's worship.
To you are, and I'm loved.
sin.
Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
What can make me whole again?
Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
This is all my hope and peace.
Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
And this is all my righteousness. Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Everything we are points to Jesus. It's all about Jesus. We can't do this without you, Jesus. We can't do this without you, Jesus. Thank you. Thank you for what you did. Because you didn't have to do it. You didn't have to leave heaven and come down here to earth. Which isn't always such a great place, but you did it. You loved us first before we even knew you. Help us to see you. Help us to recognize you. Help us to acknowledge you every moment of every day. And to live with the gratitude that you so deserve. Mm-hmm.
before I spoke a word, you were singing over me. You have been so, so a breath, you breathe your life in me. You have been so, so kind to me.
Let's take our time and sing this nice and slow.
You won't kick down, lie, you won't tear down.
love is reckless. People seem to struggle with that word sometimes, saying God could never be reckless. But here's why it's reckless, and this is what the songwriter said, is that Jesus came, he lived a perfect life, and he died a horrible killing. The worst that was there to be done in that time. Not knowing if you and I in the future would answer that, would accept that love, because he died saying, here is my heart. Here is salvation. Will you accept it? Will you accept me? Would you let me be Lord of your life? And he didn't know if we would say yes or no. How many of us are willing to love somebody who we have no idea would even like us back? Sometimes you say hi to someone and they don't even say hi back and you get your feelings hurt, right? This man came and died for the likes of you and me. What a reckless thing to do. And oh, how grateful we are, Jesus, for doing what you did. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you. And let me just say, now that you know what he did, you have to answer his question. Will you love me back? I loved you first. We'll be hearing about that shortly. Jesus.
Y cocinar. Un día yo estaba dibujando y quería unos marcadores y le pregunté a mi mamá si me podía comprar, pero ella dijo que no podía porque no tenía dinero. Hoy nos dieron unas cajas y eso me hizo sentir muy emocionada.
¡Abre tu cajita!
Cuando abrí la caja y vi que tenían estos marcadores, me sentí muy emocionada porque vinieron cosas que yo nunca pude tener, pero ahora, gracias a Dios, tengo. Yo aprendí de Dios a través de la cajita. Oré hoy para que Jesús entrara en mi corazón. Y estoy muy agradecida con todos, con Dios, con ustedes, por traerme esta cajita.
Here's how you can participate. On site, please drop off your filled shoeboxes on Sundays. Deadline, Sunday, November 7th. Online, build a shoebox online. Go to cresthill.org/connect to link to Crest Hill Church's custom page. Online, go to cresthill.org/connect to give directly on our giving page. Every shoebox gift is an opportunity to reach a child with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Go to cresthill.org/operation-christmas-child for all the details. Our 2021 goal is 100 boxes.
Good morning, church. Pastor Tommy here, glad to lead us in continuing our worship as we pray together unto God. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are thankful this morning to once again gather as your people, your church, brought together to lift up praises and to worship you together. So we pray this morning that you will once again draw us to yourself, bring us to your word, and give us an understanding of this word, new insight, so we can understand what it means to be your followers, your disciples, what it means to be your church. So together, Lord, today here this morning, we say, thank you, God, for being our God. For you are our everything. Father, you are our sustainer, meaning you pull us through and you just help us keep on keeping on. Father, you are our healer. You bring physical restoration when our bodies are down and in need of repair. Father, you are our provider, for you give us our daily bread. You are our everything. We proclaim that here together this morning. But most of all, Father, you are our Savior. For we were in need of a Savior. We were lost and entangled with our failures and sin, and you provided a way for a new birth. We owed a debt we could not pay, but glory to God, you paid a debt you did not owe, and you washed our sins away. So thank you, God, for being our Savior. Thank you for loving us enough to be willing to die for us. Your sacrifice on the cross is not overlooked this morning. So thank you, God. Thank you for the cross. As cruel and as gruesome as it was also strangely beautiful. For it demonstrated how beautiful and how deep your love goes. For you loved us enough, Father God, to give us your only Son, so that whoever believes will find salvation, will find everlasting life, will be forever in your presence in a place that you are preparing, heaven. Thank you for being our Savior. Thank you for the gift of salvation. And Lord, we pray that we can now be bearers of the good news of salvation. May we shout it from the rooftops. May we proclaim it in the workplace. May we live lives that tell what it means to be saved as we live out our lives. May we be a product of redemption and grace. So help us to represent a life that was saved, a life that was changed. And Lord, now we pray for the receiver of the gospel truth that we both live and tell. May they see in us a new creation, a life that where the old is gone, and now a new life has begun. And Lord, will you give them an ear of understanding and a heart of openness to the truth that they see in us and in the words that we share. And we pray for their salvation experience. So, Father God, right now, we pray for them by name. We pray for Joe. We pray for Steve. We pray for Scotty. We pray by name for friends and families that need a salvation knowledge and experience of you. We pray for classmates, co-workers, for those that you put in our lives and on our heart that don't have a personal relationship with you. We pray for them now. Father God, Lord, we place them at the foot of the cross. We pray for their salvation. And God, now we pray for anyone who is part of the gathering this morning, both here on our campus at Crest Hill Church and those who are watching and listening online, that if they themselves have never had a personal relationship with you, they've never personally responded to your salvation actions and the gift of restoration and rebirth that you gift, we pray that today could be a day of salvation. And to you we give all the glory and the praise. And in Jesus' name, who is our Lord and Savior, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Good morning. For those of you who do not know who I am, be it here in the house or online, I'm Jimmy Painter, and this is God's Word for today. There are three appointments that we all have. And there are three appointments that we will all keep. In this series, we have learned that our first appointment is our appointment with death. Last week, we learned that our second appointment is our appointment with judgment. And today, as we conclude this three-part series, we turn our attention to appointment number three. And appointment number three is this. It is our appointment with salvation. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 9 says, "For God did not appoint us to suffer wrath, but to receive salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ." When it comes to having our sins forgiven, when it comes to having an earthly destiny and a heavenly destination, when it comes to having hope and purpose, life and liberty, peace and a personal relationship with God, when it comes to salvation, every one of us, watch this now, has an open appointment. Recently, I saw a sign in the window of a barber shop that said, "No appointment necessary." That sign tells me that there are some barbershops that you can't just walk into off the street and get a haircut. Please hear me now. What they were saying by that sign in the window is that we are open anytime that is convenient for you to come and get what you need. Let's apply that to our appointment with salvation. God does not have a reservation book that states that we can only be saved on such and such a day, at such a time, at such and such a place. The book that God does have is the Bible. And the Bible says that we can receive Jesus Christ as our Savior on any day, at any time, and at any place. The Bible says that Paul was saved on the Damascus Road. The Bible says that Zacchaeus was saved way up in a sycamore tree. The main thing is that God does not want us to live without Him here on earth, and He does not want us to die without Him and go to hell. The Bible makes this point repeatedly and abundantly clear. 1 Thessalonians 5:9 in the easy to read version puts it plainly. God did not choose us to suffer His anger. God chose us to have salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. God has made a way for each and every one of us, and that is leaving nobody out. No one gets excluded. God has made a way for each and every one of us to experience His life-saving grace, His life-living mercy, and His life-giving salvation. Allow me today, if you will, to show you three things about your appointment with salvation. Number one, there is the now of salvation. There is the now of salvation. 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 2 says, Now is the time of God's favor. What is God's favor? It is His unearned, unmerited, I'm going to treat you better than you need to be treated and put you in places you don't deserve. Now's that time. Now is the time of God's favor. But watch this. You don't get this without you don't get that without this. Now is the day of salvation. Over the years, as I've shared the plan of salvation with individuals, when I've asked them, would you like to ask Jesus to come into your heart to be your Savior and Lord? Many of them have said to me, I want to accept Him, but I just don't feel like the time is right. When I press them on that, they'll say, when that time comes, I'll know it. And that's when I'll give my life to Jesus. Listen to me, please. You don't have to wait for goosebumps to pop out, and you don't have to wait for chills to run up and down your spine, and you don't have to wait for the clouds to part, the sun to shine, a rainbow to appear, and the strains of the hallelujah chorus to resonate in your ears to come to Jesus. You don't have to be seated on the front row in a worship service or kneeling at the altar during the invitation or in a cathedral or at a crusade to come to Christ. The Bible says that our appointment with salvation is right here, right now. Now is the day of salvation. Salvation is now. Not only is there the now of salvation, but also notice this. Number two, there is the how of salvation. The how of salvation. Romans chapter 10, verses 9 and 10 tells us that if you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, you will be saved. Let's take just a quick time out here, if we may. When we're talking about being saved, what are we being saved from? Well, we're being saved from ourselves. We're being saved from an inauthentic existence here on earth. We're being saved from having lives that have no purpose or no direction, certainly no destiny while we walk this earthly pilgrimage called life. We're also being saved from our sin that damages us and damages others, causing us not to be able to have a relationship with God and with one another. We're being saved for heaven when we leave this planet. We're being saved from hell when we leave this life. But make no mistake about it, we're being saved from God. Last week we talked about how there's an appointment with judgment, and if we die without Jesus, there is no second chance. There is no other hope. There is no plan B. So when we're talking about saved and salvation, these are the things we're talking about. You will be saved if you do what these verses say. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, and it's with your mouth that you profess your faith and are saved. Here are the facts. When people go through life denying they have sin, denying that God exists, or if he does exist, they don't need him, God cannot help them. And if that is you, God cannot help you. Notice that Romans 10 verses 9 and 10 says that there are two things that someone that is living their life without Jesus has to do. We'll call them a lost person. Number one, they have to confess. They have to open their mouth, use words, make a decision. They have to confess with their mouth that they are a sinner. That means that they've done things against God and against other people and against themselves. It means they've rejected the love of God as expressed through Christ Jesus. That if you want to have a relationship with God, you've got to, number one, confess with your mouth that you are a sinner and that Jesus is the Savior. And then number two, here's an important word, believe. And when the Bible uses the word believe, it's not talking about intellectual assent to a certain set of doctrines or dogmas. It's talking about a personal relationship. It means that you intellectually believe that these facts are true to the point that you're willing to volitionally make a decision to accept Jesus as your Savior. It's not just an intellectual proposition. It's an intellectual coupled with a volitional decision. And that usually, not always, results in an emotional expression. It's like having the engine of a train and a freight car in the caboose. If the caboose, which is the feelings, don't come along for the ride, don't worry about that. What matters most is that you know the facts and then you act on it by a decision, an act of the will. You've got to believe that Jesus is more than just a man, more than just a teacher, more than just the starter of a movement. You've got to believe that he is God, that he is the Savior, that he is your Savior. Somebody who has never received Jesus can be somebody who receives Jesus when they believe Jesus is their Savior, believe Jesus died in their place on the cross for their sins, and believe that Jesus was crucified, buried, and raised to life again, providing undeniable evidence that he is in fact the one and only Savior of the world. Romans 10:9 says that when you do this, you will be saved. God did not say in his word that maybe you'll be saved. God did not say in his word that perhaps you will be saved. God's word says you will be saved. That is the how of salvation. So we've investigated the now of salvation, and we've investigated the how of salvation. Well, that leads us to looking at a third thing, and it is this. Consider, if you will, the final critical component. There is the wow of salvation. 2 Corinthians 5:17 in the New Living Translation declares, anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new creation. The old life is gone. A new life has begun. Now, I know that some of you will say, Jimmy, I don't want to become a Christian until I know for sure I can live like a Christian. Let me articulate this as clearly as I possibly can. You cannot live like a Christian until you accept Christ. It's more about who you are than what you do. Now, when who you are is changed, you will do what a Christian does, but you can't do what you're not. You cannot live like a Christian until you accept Christ. No one ever has, no one ever will, and you are not going to be the first one to do it. You've got to get this. When your identity is transformed, so will be your lifestyle. Let me say that again. When your identity is transformed, so will be your lifestyle. You can't do it, but Christ can. Nobody is going to straighten up, fly right, and live like Jesus just because they made a list of New Year's resolutions. Nobody's going to straighten up and fly right and live like Jesus just because they joined a church. No one is going to straighten up and fly right and live like Jesus just because they were baptized, catechized, freeze-dried, or homogenized. Nobody is going to straighten up, fly right, and live like Jesus just because they gave a little money to the church or because they are there every time the church doors are open. Nobody is going to straighten up, fly right, and live like Jesus until they give their lives to Jesus. Nobody is going to live like a Christian until they are born again and become a new creation in Christ. And I came today to tell you that's not the end. That's just the beginning. That's just the beginning of your life-changing, life-quaking, Holy Ghost-filled journey with Jesus. Your appointment with salvation, get this now, is a voluntary appointment. And so if we might wade into the waters of philosophy, the question often arises, why would God make our appointment with salvation a voluntary appointment? Wouldn't it just have been better if he just would have made us all saved when we were born? Wouldn't it have just been better if he made the decision for us? Wouldn't it just have been better if somebody could have made the decision for us? Why would God do such a thing? Here is why. God has made our appointment with salvation a voluntary appointment because heaven is going to be filled full of people who voluntarily want to be there. Nobody forced them to be there, and they are there because Jesus invited them there, and they invited him into their hearts. If I might quote that great philosopher and great theologian, Bonnie Raitt, I can't make you love me if you don't. I can't make your heart feel something if it won't. We can't make other people love us, no matter how much we want them to. God has been, from the beginning, trying to get us to love him. But he loves us so much, he won't make us love him. Why? Because the key word in the Christian faith is not rules, it's not regulations, and God forbid it ain't religion. It's about relationship. And that can only come when we choose to ask Jesus, who is God, to come in to our hearts. That's called salvation. It has been said that there are three things that will surprise us when we get to heaven. First, to find many people there that we did not expect to find there. Second, to find some not there whom we had expected. And third, and perhaps the greatest wonder, will be to find ourselves there. Now, all of this sounds good, but truth be told, only two out of these three things are true. I am certain that we will be surprised when we get to heaven to find people there that we did not expect to find there. I am also certain that we will be surprised that some folks we thought would be there are not. But it is that third thing that I vehemently disagree with because it just ain't biblical. I will not be surprised to find that I am in heaven. 1 John chapter 5, verse 13 says, I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God so that you may know that you have eternal life. Key in on that word know. It is the Greek word eido, which means that we can know that we know that we know. That we can know what? We can know we are saved. We can know that this great big old God has set up residence in our heart. We can know that we have been born again. We can know we have been transformed. We can know that we belong to the family of Jesus. We can know that we are saved. Hear me, please. God does not give us an I hope so salvation. God also does not give us an I think so salvation. What God gives us is an I know so salvation. So if you don't have that kind of salvation, I say unto you today, in this house or to our friends and folks online, if you don't have that kind of salvation, you need to be worried. You need to be concerned. And the reason why is because you ain't saved. In this series, we have examined our appointment with death. We have examined our appointment with judgment. And today we have examined our appointment with salvation. Can we talk for just a second? You have every right. You have every right to ignore everything I've shared with you these past 3 weeks. But know this. One day you will find out that only God has the right to decide where you are going to spend eternity. And that decision is based solely upon what you did with His Son Jesus. An umpire by the name of Babe Pinelli once called the great Babe Ruth out on strikes. When the crowd booed the call, the legendary Big Bambino turned to the umpire and sarcastically said, "Hey, ump, there are 40,000 people here who know that that last pitch was a ball." Expecting that the umpire would erupt in anger, the manager, the coaches, the players, and the fans all braced themselves for the umpire to throw Babe Ruth out of the game. Much to their surprise, the cool-headed Pinelli looked Ruth right in the eyes and said, "Maybe so, babe, but mine is the only opinion that counts." On Judgment Day, unsaved sinners need to know that God's judgment is the only one that counts. The story is told of how the devil was trying to figure out the best way to get people to ignore the salvation of their souls. One of his demons said, "Why don't you just tell them that there's no God?" Satan said, "That's stupid. Only an idiot could not look at creation and come to the conclusion that there is no God." A second demon said, "Why don't you just tell them that there's no such thing as Judgment Day?" And Satan said, "That's absurd. If there's a God, then surely God will hold the people He created accountable for how they lived." But then a third demon spoke up and said, "I've got it. I've got it. Why don't you just say, there's no hurry?" And Satan leapt to his feet and said, "That's it. And the devil has been saying that false bill of goods for thousands of years. Hell is going to be full of people who thought they had time to get saved. But they will find that they have gambled with their souls and lost. Hear me, please. I beg of you. Satan will tell you that there is no hurry, but God says, put your house in order because you are going to die. Now, it may not be today, and it may not be tomorrow, but rest assured, we're all going to die. But perhaps it will be today. Who are you listening to? Every day, death is rapidly approaching, and every one of us had better be ready. You have, I have, we have an appointment with death. I have, you have, we have an appointment with judgment. And I have, and you have, and we have an appointment with salvation. So the question comes, now that you know, what will you do? Tick tock.
Thank you for joining us today. We have one question for you today. You just heard an amazing sermon. So what are you going to do about it? The first step is to give your life to Christ. If you've never given your life to Christ, why not today? But you just don't get it. Watching us. You don't get it by rules or rituals. You get it by having a personal, real relationship with God. If you want that today, pray this with me right now. Jesus, come into my heart. I receive you as my Lord and Savior. God, I give you my life. I give you total control of my life. I believe you are who you say you are, and I believe everything the Bible said you did. I ask you to come into my life. I know that I'm a sinner, and I ask for forgiveness today. I want to trust and follow you as my Lord and Savior. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. If you pray that with me right now, God just came into your heart to live inside of you. I want you to go right now to Crestill.org/connect to tell us about the decision you just made. This is means for a party. This is means for a celebration. So don't wait. Go to Crestill.org/connect. You'll be directed to our church's website. And then you'll just click the blue button that says connect. Fill out some information about yourself so that we can celebrate with you today about what you just did. Don't wait. Hit the blue button that says connect today. Also, if you say, hey, I know about Jesus, but I want to find a church home, you can be a part of Crestill's fellowship wherever you are across the globe. Go to Crestill.org/connect to be a part of our Crestill family today. So lastly, did you like what you saw today? Have you thought, I would love to spread the message of Jesus across the globe? Then go to Crestill.org/give to do just that. Spread the message of Jesus across the globe. God bless you. Also, I want to invite you to come next week. Matter of fact, don't just come by yourself. Have a watch party with your friends so that all of you guys can praise God together. Come along with Crestill next week. We hope to see you then. And also, we know that your time is precious, so we want to thank you so much for joining us today. We don't take it for granted. You could be doing so many other things this Sunday, but you decided to spend it with Crestill. So we thank you. We love you. God loves you. Never give up. Never give in. And as always,